here. Thanks for coming. I'm going to try to keep this fairly colloquial. You can't hear it already. I'm still battling some goo that maybe you others are dealing with. So anyway, I have one cup of coffee and one cup of water here. So this is our roasting warehouse. We don't usually have people here. We usually let people come to our coffee shops, which look a little bit nicer. But it's nice to have you here in this warehouse space, but it's not too cool temperature-wise. That's not cool. I hope you enjoy it. This is a bit of our raw processes, the background of what we take. We take green bean in the door and push it out as a brown bean back to the coffee shops. A little bit about me. Today's topic is mystery, so I'm going to start with some good advice that my uncle gave me, which was know your audience. Whenever you're speaking, and I don't really know any of you guys, a lot of different backgrounds, similar ages, but for the most part, who is in technology? A lot of technology people, finance or anything like that? Nope. A little bit? Okay, two? Great. Banking, finance, that kind of realm. Any realtors, commercial development, anything like that? All right, one. Other people? Marketing, communications, advertising, marketing, communications, advertising.
Nonprofit.
Staffing.
Great. Okay, so a lot of different people. So for myself, I'll make myself less of a mystery, as it were, and just kind of start personally and then work out. I didn't drink coffee after college. I graduated from the University of Texas in 2004 with a film degree, and no, I don't use that anymore. But I have been feeling that itch a little bit lately. I worked on a film shoot for $1 for an all night shoot, about three dudes in a hot tub. And it was grueling and horrible, and I was like, I don't know how anybody else can do this. I know I need to build up experience. I know I need to make connections, but I would also like to be off of my parents' dime, and that wasn't going to cut it. So I got a job at Central Market, and I would take home like 1 or 2 ounces of beans every day from the bulk department. And just started growing them in my house, learning more about them, getting the broad stroke differences of like different regions or types of coffee, and kind of started down that rabbit hole. At the time, I was spending a lot of time at Mozart's. Anybody know Mozart's in Austin? Neil, who works for us, works there. He is our roaster back here, which is pretty funny. But Mozart's is right on the water in Austin. It is a huge expanse of a coffee shop, and most of it is outside on a big deck. And so I would just sit up there my days off and read and write and all the things that, you know, people do on their days off. But I would be there like literally all day. And I came to just sort of enjoy what was going on. It was definitely a personal space for me. I wasn't necessarily connecting with a lot of other people, but it was also what I needed after being in college and getting a chance to read and write and discover the things that I wanted to discover now. And so it was through that and reading a lot of Wendell Berry and learning more about just valuable work that I ended up in coffee. I managed 2 stores in Austin before starting Houndstooth. In 2008, we tried to sell our house to start Houndstooth. That didn't work very well. So in 2009 and a half, we sold our house finally, and then started Houndstooth in May of 2010. So we've been able to accomplish a lot in a short amount of time, relatively. We've been open for a little less than 7 years. We have 2 stores in Austin, 2 in Dallas, roasting company here in Dallas as well, and then our new store has an attached bar called Jetson. We have another store in Austin coming this year. Anyway, I don't say that to brag. I say that to say we are a young company, and today is kind of a strange day for me personally because I feel like there is a lot of mystery as to what to expect for the next few years. Regardless of your political leanings, things are going to change. And for us, that could change in a multitude of different ways. I spent election night in New York this year, and I can tell you the feeling walking around was really strange, and it was a weird thing to be part of. It was a communal lack of knowing what to expect. Everybody was pretty deadpan the whole time. There were some people that were upset, there were some people that were just happy to be in New York, but for the most part, people were just like, I don't know. And that's kind of how I feel today, to be a little honest. Though this isn't necessarily about me, our business has to also deal with these things. One of the things that we talk about is how we participate in the global economy locally. We are truly, the beans that are over here come from different parts of the world. And if different parts of the world view us differently, we have a problem. Are people going to be willing or want to sell us coffee? Is the price of coffee going to go up due to tariffs? Is there going to be political turmoil that keeps us from getting coffee out of the country? All of these various things that go into just getting a cup of coffee in the morning, just coffee. There's so much more to it than that. Our roaster, Jonathan, and my brother, Paul, who runs our Austin stores, went to Colombia last week, and, you know, Paul came back just saying, it's amazing that coffee gets to us and that it's as cheap as it is, because it is a lot of work. And one of the things we really try to do at Houndstooth is take the mystery out of what comes behind us, all the people, all the different hands it touches. So our coffees are picked by hand multiple times. There's not like one time that they just go and pick all the trees. There's multiple pickings. That process is done by hand. There's all these different ways that it's processed, and that's generally processed by hand. It's raked across large patios as it dries, with a person walking around, sort of Zen style, making the coffees dry. And then there's also raised beds, and it has to get here on a big ship, and then we have to make sure that it arrives okay and that it wasn't affected by mold or any kind of major temperature changes while it was on the ship. Then we have to store it here, and then we roast it and make sure that we roast it really well to represent all of this, and then we give it to baristas so that they can make it. Hopefully they don't mess it up. And so that you guys can enjoy it. And it might seem like something that's kind of small, but it's also part of so many people's daily ritual and life. And we are extremely happy to be a part of it, but it doesn't make it any less work. So as an industry, we seem to value work, which I really appreciate. There's a kind of a theme that's dominating my professional life, and that's that place matters. Whenever I had the macchiato that ruined me at a place called Espresso Babache in Seattle, our wife and I went there in 2007, I tasted this coffee and I thought, wow, I never had a coffee like this. Have any of you guys had one of those moments where it was latte, cappuccino, cup of coffee, something, and you were like, Oh man,
good coffee is so good.
And I mean, it's the same thing, like, you know, like cheese or wine or beer, and it's just like, when it's good, it's just so much better than what you got before, and there was just no going back. So rather than move to a city that had an already very lively coffee culture, like Seattle at the time, Portland, I said, no, we want to do this in Texas. I'm a Texas kid. I like Texas. It's got its own weirdness and things that the rest of the U.S. doesn't understand. But we came back here to start a shop, and we try to bring that sense of place from all of these places where coffee comes to your place where you drink the coffee, whether that's a coffee shop or at home. Honestly, and with the most integrity that we can. So much of the world is a mystery. In terms of, we've never been there, we don't know what it looks like, we don't know the people, we don't know where a lot of the things that we consume come from. We try, with this little effort that we have in a coffee company, to represent place and take the mystery out of it as much as we can. But we also try to represent the place of drinking coffee. And it's no small feat to have a place for community. Amidst our short amount of time, we haven't experienced a new president as a company. We haven't experienced a poor socioeconomic or political climate yet. We haven't experienced ways probably some of you did in 2008. We were kind of past that. So as a business owner, I am curious as to how we are going to survive, not survive, thrive within this new climate. And two things have come to mind as I've been thinking about mystery, and both of which are supremely related. Our response to mystery is community and it's community and creativity. And we want to be a place where people feel community, where people come together over something as simple as coffee. That's why we're the pattern of coffee and people. And it inspires creativity. We got to think beyond what is right now. We have to be able to inspire the arts to do what they do and get us to think in a different way. And inspire each other to not just have a reason to get up in the morning, but to have life together that we want to lead. Does anybody else have a business here today? Your own business? Are these things that you guys are thinking about? Does anyone feel impervious to goings on? Yes, you do. Awesome. We'll talk later. The other thing I found about mystery and kind of where I ended up at creativity and community is looking back. We've all tried to make sense of what has become before us, whether it be the origins of the universe or the origins of the human story. There's been a creative complex that has developed this thing called language to help us understand each other better. And that understanding starts with ourselves, and then we try to communicate to somebody else, and we try to build on that to go forward. Looking back in history, we see evidence that mystery is not to be feared, that mystery, in fact, drives creativity and community. The basic mystery when each of us reaches beyond the animals who communicate with each other, and we develop a common story. For me, that common story has manifested itself in this funny thing called the pattern of coffee and people. It's the social fabric that we weave because two things happen. People want coffee and they come to get it. And in that simple, simple moment, you have people, you have coffee, and we just try to weave this social fabric every day. And with each new person, it gets a little bit more intricate and it gets a little bit more involved. And we're just trying to be honest about who we are and what we do and what we're about. And I don't know if this is just me giving a pep talk to myself today, which it probably is, so thanks for listening. But when the guest wants an Houndstooth, we don't want it to be a mysterious place. We want it to become familiar, a welcoming place for them. We want to invite them into the pattern, a pattern that existed before them and will hopefully continue to exist after them. When they feel like they're participating in it, we've done our job as hosts. We have woven the thread into the pattern that makes it even more vibrant than before. So today we're left with a lot of changes. We don't know what's coming, but we can all get to know ourselves better, get to know our world better, by getting to know each other better. And thanks for letting me speak to you guys today.